start with today's lecture by introducing, by doing a review of what we have done so far. Okay? So the topic of today's lecture is PAA with parallel predictors. This is something new we're going to talk about today, and you will understand what it means very soon. The reason for doing this parallel predictor comes from something in recursive least squares. Okay? So up till now, let's review what we have done, maybe in a different perspective. You have now seen, if we have an input, if we have a system, input u, output y, with parameters in a and b, okay, simply means we have done this, we derived this regressor model for the plan. And you see, the regressor model can be understood this way. This is a parameter. It contains all the parameters of B and A. And this phi contains the information U and Y that we can collect. Okay, so parameter and data, the inner product between these two. So you can write it in this way as well, if you see. So this difference equation multiply out. You see, yk plus 1 equals b z inverse, a z inverse, uk. So multiply out, this means nothing but a z inverse yk plus 1 equals b z inverse uk. Okay? So you can write it this way. You can immediately write it in this way. It's going to give you yk plus 1 equals BZ inverse UK, shift this on the right hand side, minus AZ inverse YK plus 1. Then you have gonna plus YK plus 1 here. So this guy is exactly equivalent to this equation here. So this equation gives you a little bit of different perspective of the system dynamics. Now you see how A and B interact in this Planck model. Now, yes? You mean this one or this one? The top one? See? Yes, we can. Yes, BZ delays, because we wrote BZ this way. I told you B0 can be zero. So it characterizes what you have said. So that's fine. But we put it this way because this is something to start with, because usually the delay is at least one step. So if you want, you can write it this way. UK plus 1. So it means, model means the delay of the Planck is 1. Look at this equation, it's 1. But it can be more if you massage, if you choose different values of BZ, negative 1. Then you can similarly derive it. Yeah, the algorithm will be different. For Planck, usually, discrete time Planck usually has one step delay. Yeah, do this case. Okay, so coming back here, I said the model can be understood this way. And I did this because of the reason. Now, using this perspective, look at recursive least squares. Now we have the a priori predictor for y, which you have seen is the estimation of theta at k times phi. So it simply replaces, it's simply using theta hat at k to replace this guy. Now, you can do similar thing. Now I have introduced the notation here. Look at this guy. We have replaced theta with estimate. Now do the same thing. Replace B with its estimate. I have put a hat here, and then I put a time index K. It means the estimate of the B polynomial at time k. If you want to know more details, it simply means this. It's replacing every B coefficient by its estimate at time k. So this is a B. You can do the same thing for A. Replace A with its estimate at time k. Then this is another perspective to see recursive D squared. Okay? So this is the a priori estimation. You can do the a posteriori estimation as well. What will change if I consider the a posteriori estimation? So you're going to have to replace k with k plus 1, and then k with k plus 1, k with k plus 1 here. So you're going to get a posteriori form. Okay, the difference is here. We have been saying that a posteriori form is easy for stability analysis, and we will use this from now on to do the analysis for introducing the main topic of today. So you can see the prediction error is y minus y hat. Then using this here, using this, let me call star. So yk minus star, you don't get yk is going to cancel because of the minus sign. Yk is going to cancel with this 1 times yk here. So you can do the algebra and convince yourself this is the result. Okay, this is a very interesting perspective to look at the prediction error. Okay, so it's a hat, k plus 1, yk plus 1, minus b hat, at k plus 1 times u, operated on u. So put it in a block diagram, and this is what you can see. Epsilon k plus 1 equals yk plus 1 operated on a hat minus uk going through b hat. Okay, so you see, this makes sense. And then how do you get yk plus 1 out of uk? You process it through the plug. Any questions for this part? This is a this is very important for what we're gonna be with what we're gonna be deriving very soon. Any questions? Okay. Microphone is if you don't have questions, then take a look at this structure. Look at how the estimated parameters A hat and B hat behave in this block diagram. A hat is in series with the plant. A hat is in series with the plant. And B hat is in parallel with the plant. So this can be called a series parallel adjustable system. Parallel. From this equation star, look at about it. If stability holds, if stability is not an issue, so that epsilon will go to zero, okay? So this simply means asymptotically, your y hat is going to approximate y. So in that case, it seems someone look at this and then proposed, since y hat approaches y, why don't we replace y in this equation star with y hat? So that's the observation here. And it turns out this kind of modification have some benefits, and this is what we're going to talk about today. So we can do similarly derive the block diagram analysis of this new equation one. This is my equation one for today's lecture. So we can do similar analysis, derive this block diagram, and it comes as follows. Now you see, look at this structure here. You can massage equation one into this block diagram, this input-output behavior. So shift, I think you can just simply cancel this one, cancel y hat on both sides. Cancel y hat with this one times y hat here. Then shift y hat to the left-hand side. You can get this input and output dynamics. So it gives you a little bit different perspective. Now, look at this guy. UK going through the estimated plumb gives you y hat. And when you consider the a posteriori estimation error, it's defined as follows. Remember, yk plus 1 minus y hat. Yk plus 1 coming out of here, this is standard. And this is the new estimated output. And this minus sign here. Now, you see, it's different from what you saw just now. What you saw, this is series parallel structure. And now, you don't have the series part here to give you the estimation error. You only have this parallel structure. So this is the parallel here. This is the parallel structure for this type of parameter adaptation algorithm. Okay, so two structures. And I mentioned, it turns out doing so has certain advantages. Now before we discuss the advantages, let me give you some other names that different people has different preferences. Some people call this parallel structure as an output error method, because it's deriving the error of the output of the plumb and the output of the estimated plumb. Okay, so this is one name. And then because of this, the way this is called, then we have another name for this serious parallel structure. It's called an equation error method. The equation error method coming out of this equation here. It's coming out of here. So it's an equation error compared with this output error. Okay, so now block diagrams. Since difference, if you have noise in the system, and usually you will have noise in the system. Now, take a look at the case. If you have noise in the system, then you're gonna have, suppose you have your plant, the output of your plant is contaminated by noise. Then you're going to have this. This is a plant, and at the output of the plant, you have a noise term. So this is a parallel structure. Similarly here, at the output of the plant, you have a noise structure here. Okay. So look at this. Can someone just intuitively tell me which one will be better? Give me any reason. So you mean, the noise will go through this A hat. That's one very good observation. So makes sense to everyone? So next parameter is going to be, this noise is going to go through this, okay? And over here, you don't have this noise going through this estimated parameter. This looks like very clean compared to this, okay? So it turns out doing this is better than this when you have noise, usual case. Only under very optimistic case of the noise here will these two be relatively equivalent. not equivalent, relatively performing at the same level of performance. So now we have done, we have introduced the parallel adjustable system, which is the motivation is to improve the performance under the noisy conditions. And you have understood now what is the difference between series parallel and parallel structures. What we're going to do now is to start with the recursive least squares based parallel parameter adaptation algorithm. So we'll start with what we know now, and then take a look at the details of the stability requirement. Okay, and then hopefully in the next few lectures, we're going to be able to see why this is really making good behavior compared to the series parallel structure. Okay, so let's take a look at the first term, recursive least squares based parallel parameter adaptation algorithm. So I'm assuming here the Planck is the usual definition of the Planck. You have the numerator denominator divided by this, and then this is the estimated parameter. So summarizing, I think I'm going a little bit too fast. Let me review first the recursive least squares. So standard recursive least squares, you remember we have this yk plus 1. If I'm using these notations, I'm assuming this is the Planck, then you're going to have a theta transpose phi k. Then if I want, I can write it this way, to minus a z inverse minus 1 yk plus 1. So this is simply essentially deriving again how the parameter adaptation algorithms look like. So it's a snapshot of what you have seen earlier. So putting what B and A looks like over here, your AZ minus 1, your AZ to the power of negative 1, because there's a negative 1 term, so this guy is going to get canceled. We're going to have A1Z negative 1, A2Z negative 2, YK plus 1. So here, can someone immediately tell me what is phi and what is theta here? I think my notation for theta is I'm doing this order: a1, a2, an, b0, b1, bm. What is phi here? What is phi here? A1 is going to be multiplied by negative yk. So it's negative yk minus 1, and then go all the way. When you hit negative yk, then you can figure out the index. Then you're going to have B0 times uk, then uk minus m. Okay? So this is what I want to take a look at during this review. Look at the phi index here. This is dependent on yk, okay, all the information about yk. Now, you do parallel structure, what will change, essentially? Now, if you consider parallel ILS, what will change? So if you have recursive least squares and you do a posterior estimation, you're going to have y hat. Everything becomes hat. Theta hat k plus 1. And then this is going to all be replaced by hat. So I won't. I don't have enough space to put the hat here. But you know what I mean. I'm just saying everything is going to be replaced by hat. And then the index is going to be k plus 1. So what will change in parallel? what will y hat k plus 1 be? Yeah, so essentially, you can do the similar structural analysis and see what we have derived so far. Yk plus 1 is going to be b, the estimation of b at time k plus 1, minus a at time k plus 1, minus 1, then y, what is here? What is happening here? That's the essential difference. Okay, so on the right-hand side, everything will be depending on y hat instead of y. So the difference is here. Now. Okay. Theta hat. Phi. Now you're gonna have because of y hat in all these regressor elements. Questions? So the change in phi is here. And then the parameter adaptation algorithm, the structure will be exactly the same. Theta hat k plus 1 equals theta hat k updated on these. Okay? So the same structure. I have been mentioning that. So this is the parameter adaptation for parallel PAA. This is the central equation. Okay. I have been mentioning that implementation is sometimes straightforward, but the difficulty sometimes is how you analyze your algorithm, convince people. The equation looks completely fine. When you implement it, you will see the performance. The difference here is now analyzing the stability. This will be different compared to the standard recursive d-squares. What we have been mentioning that standard recursive d-squares will have guaranteed asymptotic stability, okay? Now, the main message is, if you do parallel PAA, you will not get that good property. Okay, so let's see how it works. Now we have the parameter estimation error, theta tilde. You can do, everything is the same derivation. So theta tilde will be theta tilde k plus f times phi times epsilon. And then look at the let's take a look at the block diagram structure. So this is, I'm going to tell you what we are aiming at first, and then explain the detailed construction of each element. So since we'll be exactly the same, we are going to derive, in the end, this is what we are going to derive. Nonlinear structure, and then linear structure. And the output is going to be epsilon k plus 1, and then here it's going to be theta tilde k plus 1 transpose times phi k here. Okay, this is in the end what we're going to derive. Okay, now this part coming out of here, so we have something we know about theta tilde. So this equation here, let me call equation box. Equation box will give us this, give us a nonlinear block diagram. The remaining task is to derive how epsilon k plus 1 and this guy, how epsilon k plus 1 can be expressed as something related to this. This is what we're going to do. Okay. So the way to do that is from the following analysis. First, we have the Planck So, which is equivalent to this, the difference equation here. And by far, by now, you probably are getting familiar with this a posteriori output error structure. So replace every B with its estimate, replace A with its estimate, and then replace Y with its estimate. This is the parallel structure we have been talking about. So this is the parallel ROS based. So I've been mentioning what we want is something about epsilon k plus 1. To get epsilon k plus 1 out of these two equations, what you can do is subtract the first one by the second one. You are going to get on the right hand side, let me write it instead. So subtract these two, you get az minus 1 yk plus 1 minus a hat z negative 1 k plus 1 y hat k plus 1 equals bz inverse uk minus b hat z inverse uk plus 1, no uk, k plus 1 uk. Okay? So I want to get something about epsilon k plus 1. Anyone give me a suggestion how I can do that? I cannot directly subtract these two and get epsilon k plus 1 because this is a hat, right? What can I do to generate something that I can safely do the subtraction? Okay, so everyone see the motivation here? I can't directly get it, so I do a add and subtract items. So I'm adding and subtracting A, because this way I can safely subtract, because they are both A here, and I have Y hat here. So this minus this will give me epsilon K plus 1. Okay, so that's the motivation here. So if you do that, you have to do this, add and subtract terms, then you're going to see this minus this, you're going to get az minus 1, yk minus this is going to give me epsilon k plus 1. Then the second term is going to be a hat, z, negative 1 k plus 1, y hat k plus 1, plus az inverse. Okay, so take a moment to look at this structure. I'm going to put it in the order of, I think, A minus, this is A minus A hat. Y hat. Okay, this is the left hand side, okay, equals this. the right hand side is going to be equal B minus B hat K plus 1 UK. Okay? These two are equal. So if you remember, let me write it now. So this left hand equal simply means this. Okay? So A, epsilon k plus 1, if you shift this guy to the right hand side, you're going to get equals B minus B hat, z minus 1, k plus 1, then minus this term here. I am intentionally guiding you to get something seen before. Here. Let's look at the two terms separately. Look at the first term, for example. This star term. Z minus 1 is B0, B1 to Bn. When you subtract this with this, you are going to get BZ minus 1 minus B hat Z minus 1. Let me use K plus 1. This equals B0 minus B0 hat K plus 1 brackets plus B1 minus B1 hat K plus 1 Z negative 1. Go all the way. Keep on going. Okay? Now when you what is this? What are the individual terms here? This is the parameter estimation error, right? My notation is gonna be, I'm gonna define my notation, I'm gonna define bi tilde, the parameter estimation error at k plus 1, as bi hat k plus 1 minus bi. This is the notation. Okay, we're going to use. So this is going to be b0 tilde, minus b0 tilde, k plus 1, minus b1 tilde, k plus 1, z negative 1, all the way. Okay? And when you consider now the input, you going through this polynomial, you are going to get plus 1. You're going to get negative. Let me see. Now I'm going to put it in a little bit more compact form. So pay a little bit of attention here and see how this is constructed. Negative B0 tilde K plus 1. I'm going to put it in a vector form. Then here, B1 tilde K plus 1, go all the way down. B0 tilde is going to be operated, it's going to be multiplied by what? When you filter UK through this. UK, because UK is going through this polynomial, and there's no delay. What about this one? UK minus 1, then go all the way down. Okay? So you see, now I'm going to tell you why I'm doing this here. You have seen previously the output prediction here. You see, the bottom part here, UK to UK minus N, is the same as this, okay? And this part, B tilde, this part, is gonna be exactly in the same structure of this, okay? So, intentionally, I'm gonna guide you to something related to the regressor model. So this is the process for the star. You can do the same analysis for this, for the other term. So summarizing, for the star term, you're gonna get in the end this. Okay, so we have introduced the notation is a negative B0 tilde here. Okay, so do exactly the same thing for this guy. You can see essentially the structure will be exactly the same, right? You just replace B with A, and y, u with y hat. So the result is this. So similarly, for a in this polynomial form, it's going to look like this. Replace u with y hat and replace b with a. You're going to get this. Okay? Now, look at these two. And then tell me now, yes. Yes. Let me see, is n or n plus 1? I think it's n plus 1. Yeah. I just wanted to give you the credit. But you said it's n, it's actually n plus 1. So I cannot give it to you. Ah. So, yeah. Now we have this. I'll just give it to you now. Now we have this, and then take a look at the original structure. So this is what we have obtained. Okay? This guy minus this guy. I have already, I don't have enough space. Let me see how I can best. So I am going to have this is what we derive, AZ minus 1 epsilon K plus 1 equals, let me write it again because I don't have space to show it here, minus y hat k plus 1. Okay? Oops. So essentially, now you see, I can't put it on the slide, so I'll give you the full result and see how we can. How we can see whether, what kind of questions. Final compact representation of the result. But you can see the intuition here. Phi k contains y hat and u. Okay, here. Phi k contains y hat and u. Y hat and u. So y hat is going to be operated, it's going to be multiplied by the estimation error, AI tilde negative, okay, here. Okay, so it's, these are the parameter estimation error, part of the parameter estimation. And we have seen the other part of UK is gonna be dependent on the scaling ahead are B tilde, are here. The scaling, because ahead of them are the parameter estimation errors of B. So in the end, if you put these two together, this is the final conclusion. AZ times epsilon is going to be equal to this guy. Okay, this is the final conclusion. Okay, just to do the algebra, this is what you will get. So any questions? This is the disadvantage of doing this. Space to put everything I want in the same slide. we'll just have to stick with it. Any questions for this? So if not, you see the difference here. In the recursive these squares, the result is that epsilon k plus 1 equals negative theta tilde k plus 1 transpose phi k. Okay, this is in recursive these squares. We have simple now you have this, okay? But if you want, you can write it this way. You can write it now in parallel based ILS. If you consider your input is the same thing, is this guy. Okay? Is this guy. So you can derive in this. Now you can construct a block diagram. Okay, we have now output as epsilon, and then the input to this LTI block is negative of theta tilde times transpose times phi. It's negative of this guy. So things are looking good here. And then in the bottom structure is this guy. Which we have seen. We have seen last time how this nonlinear block is constructed. So I will not talk about again. Okay? So you see, this structure is exactly the same as what we talked about last time. So it's intuitive to understand that this satisfies the Popov inequality. What is different now is this guy. To be have a quadratic hyperstability, what is PR for this? Okay, so it turns out SPR for okay. So I'll set up the problem now. So the problem I'm considering now is again the simplified case where FK equals a constant. We'll talk about when FK is time-varying. So if FK is a constant, then everything else on the bottom part is the same as ROS. So the bottom part satisfies the Popov inequality. And then we require the bottom, the top block diagram to be SPR. Okay, so if it's SPR, then we have asymptotic hyperstability. Now, look at this guy. It depends on the Planck. And you will, after you get more experience, you will see this guy is usually not SPR. And we won't have this nice stability consider, nice asymptotic stability compared with RLS. This guy has good performance as we. Someone, several are proposed to reduce the SPR condition for this guy. Okay, this is what we're going to talk about for the next few slides. Okay. I'll come back to this slide later. So what we're going to talk about next time, in the next few slides is this. Parallel parameter adaptation algorithms with relaxed R conditions. Okay. What will be, suppose now you are the designer, what will be something that you can consider to make this SPR condition? It's looking at modify. What would you propose to modify here? do it where? Here. Yeah. So this is very close to what I wanted to do next. So remember, in recursive discourse, I have this is identity. So a naive way is, how about I do some algebra, I do some operation to make this, this is just an idea, so how about I do something like this? If I can somehow introduce this, introduce the filtering in this level, then this becomes one. Then we have asymptotic hypersubstability. What will be the trouble here? Yeah, we don't know this. So we don't know. Before we have the parameter adaptation algorithm, before we identify the problem, we won't be able to know what kind of filtering we should construct. So the actual way we're going to discuss is we filter by something, by some polynomial. And we'll first talk about, let's hope that this is close to A. And then we'll talk about how to make this guy. If we really don't have any knowledge of A, then how about we sort of make this adaptive? So we make this adaptive so that we can approximate A online. That's the two steps we're gonna do. Okay, so let's look into more details of this idea. This is called parallel algorithm with a fixed compensator. This fixed compensator is this guy, what we have been talking about here. Okay, instead of doing this, standard PAA, do instead one more step. Do instead, so I'm replacing standard error with this new adaptation error. I think it's the way to read it is, it's called nu, Greek. Nu naught. This is a new adaptation error. And it's defined by this way. The a posteriori adaptation error is defined by exactly the intuition over there in the last slide. So process epsilon by a compensator C, which is defined by this. C0, C1, to all the way to Cn, okay? This is the a posteriori, and this is the a priori, okay? So the a priori definition of the adaptation error is gonna be use as much information as you can. Use as much a posteriori information as you can. So you see here, I'm all using a posteriori information. These are available when I'm considering at time k plus 1. So I can get all these previous a posteriori errors. And then at k plus 1, we won't be able to get epsilon k plus 1. So we won't be able to get this times this. So replace with the best we can do, the a priori estimation. Okay. This is the filtering process. Then as an exercise, so derive that under these modifications, the equivalent feedback block, the equivalent block diagram is gonna be CZ inverse, AZ inverse, and then the nonlinear block. Now here, the only difference is this. Instead of epsilon, we have nu here. Okay? So, would you guys, do you want me to derive it, or is you can do it yourself? Do you want me to do it? okay, good. So as an exercise, derive this block diagram structure and then see the stability requirement. Let me write it here. Stability requirement. So if FK, this is what we have been assuming at the beginning of the course, so earlier. So for constant adaptation gain, stability requirement is going to be, again, Popov inequality. This is a, this is what we have seen this before. So Popov, this guy is relatively easier. And then we're going to need CZ negative 1, AZ negative 1 to be SPR for the case of constant adaptation gain. Keep in mind, constant adaptation gain. Okay? Turns out, if we have time-varying adaptation gains, since we'll be slightly more involved, the SPR condition is going to be, this guy is the same as earlier what we see. We have an additional term, okay, which lambda depends on the adaptation, the forgetting factor in the parameter adaptation algorithm. Okay, but these are the details. The central message is that we can have relaxed SPR requirement using this design. Okay? So let's follow up and then extend the idea more, a little bit more. We have been mentioning, okay, now if we really don't have idea of A, then it doesn't help. If we have no idea of A, it doesn't help you do C divided by A and you select some C, because it's hardly likely that you just select some random C that can match your A. So instead, make this adaptive. This is the idea of parallel algorithm with an adjustable compensator. Make this C adaptive and make it online approach A. This is the idea. Make this guy adaptive. Then construct a parameter adaptation algorithm. Okay, so the idea is very similar again. Nu is going to be epsilon processed by this adaptive version of C. Then you can similarly construct the a priori estimation adaptation error, so which is going to be. Everything else is the same. It's just the first element at k plus 1, at time k plus 1, is using the a priori estimation error. Then things will be the same. The structure of PAA is the same. But here, the only difference is now, instead of theta hat, you have to adapt also C1 to Cn. So you have to also adapt these guys. So your parameter vector is going to be expanded a little bit. And then your regressor vector is going to be, so the first part is exactly the same. And then the second part will be slightly, considering this, considering C1, C2, Cn is multiplied by epsilon, will be containing these data vectors here. Okay? And then the adaptation gain will be exactly the same structure. So this guy, the conclusion, the result coming out of this is that we can get this nonlinear block. The result is this. We have now, again, have the identity block in the PAA. So this looks pretty nice. What will be one some disadvantage of? you can derive, it's always one. It's not asymptotic to one. From stability perspective, it looks great. What about from computation perspective? Now you have to, essentially you have a larger computation load because you have to do this as well. So your adaptation vectors, all these algorithms, their dimension is gonna increase. That's the, from the computation perspective, that's the okay. We have seen these three algorithms. We can have a little bit of overview. General parameter adaptation algorithm. Okay. Well, you can. I'll just put H as a general LTI transfer function. And then you can recognize that if H is one, then we are going to have recursive least squares or parallel predictor with adjustable compensator. When H is 1 divided by A, this is the case we started today. It's the parallel predictor, a direct parallel predictor. And if it's Z divided by A, we're gonna have parallel predictor with a fixed compensator, okay? So this is, and then the difference with different cases is the how SPR condition is different in these three cases. Okay, so hopefully you have now a general big picture of the PAA stability for parallel structures. Now I want to come back to the case to something I have mentioned earlier, but I didn't prove it. So I mentioned if FK is a constant, okay, so this guy being SPR is sufficient for asymptotic stability. Turns out this is the conclusion for the next few slides. If FK is time varying, obeying the parameter adaptation algorithms, if FK is this, if FK is this kind of time varying adaptation gains, okay, which is what we have been using for now, then the stability requirement is going to be is slightly more demanding condition. Instead of H, we are required to have H minus this being SPR. Okay, so slightly more demanding conditions. And this is what we're gonna do for the remainder of today's course. So PAA with time-varying adaptation gains, we're gonna revisit this topic and then explain the stability requirement. All right? So here is the basic challenge for this. If we have time-varying adaptation gain, okay, this time-varying nature is gonna make the nonlinear block more mathematically involved. And then the result is that this block diagram, this nonlinear block diagram by itself is no longer passive, does not satisfy Popov inequality. Okay? So we will do we'll do some algebra to make it to make the Popov inequality come back. That's what we're gonna do. All right? So here is the. This is the previous. This is what we have derived. We have the edge is an LTI block, and nonlinear block is satisfied by the PAA equation, theta tilde k plus one equals theta tilde k plus f k phi k epsilon k plus one. If I'm using epsilon as the error message here. Then, here is the case. Add and subtract two blocks. Add and subtract lambda 2 divided by 2. So here, let me tell you what's the definition of lambda 2. lambda 2 definition is lambda 1 by k transpose. Okay. So lambda 2 is the forgetting factor here. Add and subtract lambda 2 divided by 2. And then add and subtract again lambda divided by 2. Lambda is the maximum of lambda 2. Okay, so this is the trick we're going to play. And the central message is going to be, if you do that, then consider this new construction. It turns out this bottom part containing these several blocks is going to be passive. So this itself is not passive, but this add and subtract these is going to make it passive. Okay? Let me give you some intuition here. This guy, so look at this part first, these two parts first. You can see it's going to be, let me see, if I'm considering the minus sign here, so I'm considering this minus and this plus, so these two can be put together. I am going to have here 1 divided by 2, half of lambda minus lambda 2k. Okay, so essentially, I am putting this inside here. Essentially, this is what I'm going to do. So this line is the same as this line, so I can put this here. And then I can put this line over here. But this is plus, this is minus, so this becomes minus sign here. So if you do that, then it becomes this guy. Okay? So what did we say? I said lambda, the maximum lambda 2k. So this guy will be not zero, larger than or equal to zero. So this block, is it passive or not? This block itself. It's passive. So then this is passive, and then we're going to show that this guy is passive. Then combination of two passive blocks in this structure is going to be passive. That's what we're going to show. Okay. And let's see. Summarizing what we have said. This is what we're going to do. We're going to show that this is what you have seen. We have shown that this is passive. What we're going to show is this. So if you take out this block, is this. We're going to show that this is passive. And then these two combinations is going to be passive because it's a feedback connection of two passive blocks. Okay? This is step two. So the final step is what you have seen. It's the SBR condition for the linear block. Okay. Now, why don't you take a 2-minute break? Because you're going to see massive equations. So take a moment, take a break and see. Make sure you understand the big picture, and then we're going to go through the detailed mathematics. I'll be right back. hopefully you have got the big pictures. Now let's dig into the details. About passivity of this block, I mentioned that this is the step to do first. So I'm defining the input of this block as SK and the output as WK, okay? And the input-output, the detailed relationships are WK equals theta tilde transpose times phi K. This is the same as last time. What's different is now SK and epsilon K, they have this dependence. So epsilon K equals SK minus the output times lambda 2. So let me write it actually. Epsilon K plus 1 equals SK minus WK times lambda 2K divided by 2. Huh? Minus, right? Yeah. So massage this into this. SK equals epsilon K plus 1 plus this guy, lambda 2 divided by 2 times this. This is WK. Okay. So this is this. Then we will consider the passivity of this block, this overall block. You got to consider the input-output behavior. So putting W equals theta tilde transpose times phi and S equals this, okay? And then notice that the adaptation gain equation is looks like this. So when you multiply out, the first term is gonna be not much difference. So theta tilde transpose times phi times epsilon, then plus half of, so I think I need a little bit here. So do the second part, you're gonna get theta tilde transpose k plus 1 phi k, then lambda 2k divided by 2 theta tilde transpose k plus 1 phi k. Okay? Put this equals, let me do one more step. 1 divided by 2 theta tilde transpose k plus 1. Then lambda 2k, this is scalar, I can put it anywhere I want. I can combine, now I can combine phi k with the remaining part. So this is, I'll tell you the result first. I'll explain it to you very soon. So you see, I have taken the transpose, this is a scalar, so it equals its own transpose. I take the transpose, then phi here goes to the left, becomes this. And then this equals, use this equation now. This equals, let's see, F inverse K plus 1 minus lambda 1K F inverse K. So doing these two, you are going to get this final term here. 1 divided by 2 theta transpose. In the bracket, you have what we divide here. Then on the right-hand side is theta tilde. Okay, so I'm doing this, I'm intentionally doing this to create, you see, some kind of quadratic forms of theta tilde. So as you can imagine, similar to what we have done previously, in the end, I'll do some complete of squares, completing the squares kind of thing. Okay? So we have now the second part. Let's put it aside first and then focus on the first part to see how this guy looks like in more details. You can use the parameter estimation error equation. So again, the idea is create something that's quadratic about theta tilde. So I can substitute phi times epsilon by its result here. So I'm gonna get F inverse K theta tilde minus theta. Okay. Now we have this combination of second order things. So this final passivity consideration becomes this. Okay, so it's going to be after some algebra. This is the massive mass part I mentioned earlier. After some algebra, it's going to turn out that this summation here, you see, is some kind of quadratic function of theta tilde, and then some kind of quadratic, not now quadratic, but some kind of functions of theta, but which is has a cross product term with theta tilde. So after some complete of squares kind of operation, after some complete of squares of operation, we can make this quadratic, look at the structure here, quadratic term of theta tilde, quadratic term of this, there's a typo, quadratic term of this theta tilde k plus 1 minus theta tilde k, some kind of quadratic term. Okay, this will immediately, look at this, this will immediately give us the cross product term between theta tilde k plus 1 and theta tilde k, which is here. Okay, and finally, some kind of quadratic functions that's quadratic summation of quadratic functions that looks like in this structure. So you have seen last time that this summation, because of the minus sign here, when you add everything up, it's going to be equal to this. So which is going to be larger than, it's going to be no less than negative of 1 divided by 2, theta tilde, theta transpose 0, F inverse 0, and then theta tilde 0. Okay, what about parts? They are all non-negative, right? These are all non-negative. These are quadratic functions. These are all quadratic functions. So the main result we're going to get in the end is that this, when we consider passivity of this W times S, in the end, we're going to see it's going to be no less than this guy, no less than some lower bound. This is the final result. Okay. Then we can show, indeed, passive. All right? Then we're going to have, this is passive, and then that this guy is SPR, okay? So the summary we're going to get is that this nonlinear block is indeed passive, and then it's sufficient that the bottom, the top LTI block is SPR. Let's see, I don't have time. Let's see how much I have. This is what I'm gonna do. Leave this as a reading material after the lecture. So read it yourself, and then at the end of the semester. Here we announce that the last two or three lectures I won't broadcast. I will do the board. Over there I will explain the mathematical derivations that are not convenient to present, such as this, not convenient to present in a PPT setting. And then over there we will talk about all these heavy algebra over there. Okay? All right. So.